I would like to welcome you to the second Suley Brand Talk. The first one happened in, today's March, April, right? I think April, at the Pacific Place. And the first Suley Brand Talk was on the magic behind brands and their creative directors. I shall introduce myself. My name is Yuliya Suleymanova. I am the co-founder of Suley Group, and Suley University is a part of Suley Group, and also co-founder of Suley Air, which is multi-digital media platform. And I am a PhD candidate, and I'm working for the last 3 years, I've been working toward my PhD dissertation thesis. It's been a very interesting experience because my focus of my thesis is on branding. And I think many of us are not very clear what branding is. And branding is a combination of many disciplines, and that's where I draw my data, my research from disciplines like, yes, marketing, consumer behavior, psychology, brand management, and many other disciplines. So it is quite hard to find an information that I'm looking for. My the concentration of my thesis is on consumer behavior and luxury fashion market. So, as I mentioned before, for the last 3 years, I've been doing research, and now I feel like I need to go public and share my knowledge that actually I can say it's really hard to find. And brands, any kind of brands, we're talking about not only fashion, but we're talking about automobile industry, food, restaurants, hotels, any kind of industry or any kind of brands, they would not share with you any information on how they build their legacy, what their legacy is built on. We can make assumptions on what they do to build their following and turn them into loyal followers. They will not tell you if you ask them. And it's very interesting that all the academic research that I am getting on branding, meaning how brands built their legacy, right? Actually, what I'm finding is just very short interviews with brand executives, maybe 10, maybe 20 minute interviews, and that is all. So Chanel, Cartier's, Swarovski's of the world, they will not tell you how they build a connection and inspire us and aspire us to buy their products. Branding is a connection between, actually it's a psychology of objects. So how can I inspire and aspire you to buy this computer or to buy this bottle of water or to buy this camera, right? How would I inspire you and aspire you, there are two different words, to buy an object? Not only inspire and aspire you, aspire meaning to be like, to look like, to buy an object, an item, not only inspire you and aspire you, but you continue to buy that product or those products from me, me as a brand, right? Me as a business. How can I convert you into not only customer, but a long-term loyal consumer, right? How, so these are the things that that is very interesting to me, and that's what this today's conversation, part of what I'm been researching is about. And this particular talk today is going to be on the phenomenon of art infusion. And no wonder we're here at the Ryan James Fine Arts Gallery. Ryan, thank you for hosting us at your beautiful gallery. You had a chance to review the art, and actually you had an assignment, did you? Yes, you did. You had an assignment. Don't turn your eyes. You had an assignment, and that assignment is to review artwork. And then there were a couple of questions that you need to answer. And those questions that we'll collect, they'll be a part of this talk tonight. And they'll help me and then us to justify the subject matter of this conversation. And yes, it is, I would like to have a conversation, because many of us are either have businesses or would like to open a business, and it doesn't matter if you're an artist, if you're creative, if you're, you know, sell, it doesn't matter what you sell, right? It doesn't matter products or services. We all have, we all need to create a certain perception in our clients, in our customers' minds, right? Or prospects to purchase our goods and services. And even if it is a piece of art, we still need to create a certain philosophy, certain vision that will encourage and inspire people to come and learn more about that this particular artist and purchase his or her art. So today's conversation, so what we're going to do is I'm going to present, and I will have, in a way, I'd like to have, as I said, some kind of conversation. You'll see how it goes. I'll give you some questions, so to speak. And then when I present, then afterwards we'll have a, questions, time for your questions. So I try not to make it, sound very academic, and keep it quite light, so you can understand, you can understand the content, and you can apply the that content to whatever you do. Does it make sense? So I try to make it less academic sounding, so you can understand what I'm trying to say. But yes, there are some academic sounding terminology going to be in the conversation, in the topic, in the talk. And then after the talk, we'll have questions and answers, and then we'll look into survey data that we've collected. For those that have not had a chance to take survey, I will give you, it'll be 2 minutes to take the survey, and you do need to review the art around you in the gallery. So, any questions so far? Yes, it is a conversation, so, but there'll be time when I'm gonna be talking. And if you do have a question, really something that is mind-boggling, but you can raise your hand, and I can take that into consideration, note it, and then try to answer it, or I can answer it afterwards. So today's conversation is, as I said, the phenomenon of art infusion, the influence of visual art on the perception and evaluation of consumer products. So I am going to state, I'm going to give you a statement of the whole talk, right? And the statement is that the phenomenon of art infusion represents visual art that has a favorable influence on the evaluation of consumer product. So the presence of art, of visual art, is affecting the way we consumers evaluate the product. And it is a favorable influence, meaning if we have a presence of visual art on the, either in the context of packaging, product design, or advertising, therefore we will give our preferences to that product. Does it make sense what I'm saying? I'll be kind of giving, I don't want to sound too academic. Okay, so that's the statement. Throughout the history, we all know that the art has had the ability to arouse the imagination and capture our attention. And there are some examples, just some of the examples that we can look at, as this particular piece is Gucci. Gucci, you probably know or heard of the Gucci brand, right? The fashion brand, high-end fashion brand, Italian fashion brand. And that is their campaign, advertising campaign, summer spring of 2018 by Ignacy Monreal. I believe the Spanish artist. As you can see, it echoes with a number of art influences from Baroque and Renaissance, right? So next one, let's see. We see the influences of art in the hotel interiors, right? Something like that. You might recognize some of the masterpieces of the Western art on the walls, right? And as you can see, those that are familiar with interior design, you can see the whole style, right? The style of the furniture, of the satin, right? The satin of the cushions and the carpets and all of that is a congruent representation of all pieces, all items, from chandeliers to artwork on the walls, to the carpets, to the tables, and sofas, and so on and so forth. We see the wallpaper that is Klimt, right? The famous artist's copy of his work. As you can see, we use it as a wallpaper. As I mentioned before, art images are being used, visual art images are being used in the context of packaging, product design, or advertising. There are two main functions why we would use visual art images in packaging, advertising, and product design. And these are the two basic functions. Number one is to enhance, right? To enhance the product that is being advertised. A car commercial, hotel commercial, right? Restaurant commercial. When we use art image, right, art object, that is what? That is unrelated object, right, to the restaurant, mm-hmm. right? The visual art image is unrelated, but somehow there is a congruency, right? There is a relationship between that. So, and of course, to enhance. Why? To enhance. And number two is to integrate art image into the actual product design. Does it make sense what I'm saying? This two, right? Integrated part of the product, that is packaging, product design. And these are some of the examples, right? The wine bottles, pillows, wallpapers, and so on and so forth. So what I'm talking here about is the influence, right? The influence of art. And that is a phenomenon called art infusion. The impact that visual art mm-hmm. does to objects, for the most part, unrelated objects. And this is the definition. We define it as the general influence, right, of the presence of art on consumer perceptions and evaluations of products with which it is associated. That is the official definition of the phenomenon of art infusion. The influence, right? We're talking about, this is the talk, this is what the talk is about. The influence, right? The influence of visual art on unrelated objects. Why would we care about this object, about this subject? Well, vast amounts of money are spent on representing visual arts in conjunction with products. And marketers has a hope that the product that is being advertised with visual arts images become marketable. And then we're talking about 23.5 billion global art market, right? So the opportunities are endless. But there is still a gap in understanding how and what the impact of using visual art objects with visual arts on them as a part of the design or either in advertising. So there's still a huge gap in knowledge and understanding how it all works. So just little seeds of information here to uncover. So I would like to give you some of the samples, examples, and I would like your input here. Let's look at some of the examples where images, art images, are being used. And as I said, there are two, as you might remember, there are two basic functions why we use visual art images. Number one, to enhance, right, the product that is being used, being advertised or promoted, right, to enhance that object. Number two is what? When visual art becomes a part of the design, right, a part of the design of the product. So let's have a look. Okay, so this is to enhance. So my question would be, each example that I'm going to show you, you're going to choose either, is the sample where art image is enhancing the product that is being promoted, or it is an integrated part of a design, right? That would be my question. So the first example is Absolute Vodka, Andy Warhol edition. Okay, let's play it.
We'll be right back.
Okay. So my question to you, two functions, right? To use the art, representation of art. What is it in this case? What do you think?
To make alcohol our friend, right?
Okay.
It's like to make an alcohol our best
play from the card.
The best friend for you. And how much money are you going to pay for your best friend, right?
Okay, yes. Okay. Anybody else? So we remember that.
I saw the last one, it was my friend. And absolute vodka. So this is
the wording.
Tricky play with video, video shots very fast, and I couldn't really read what's going on, what kind of information. So, and the short, the light one was my friend and vodka. That's the last that I remember.
The messaging.
Absolutely.
And fast, but very
flipping.
And Warhol is. So this, a bit of this project was an opportunity to pay a tribute to one of our favorite artists, Andy Warhol, both to his art and to his thoughts. And this particular advertising was conceptualized and throughout the campaign to celebrate Warhol's fascination with the world's most famous vodka bottle. So his fascination with vodka. So my question is, yes, these are all great ideas, and the thoughts is correct. But what are the functions of the art using the Warhol's conceptual art of representing vodka? What is behind it? Number one, do you remember? To enhance or to use as integrated part of the product? To enhance, absolutely. So in this case, we're using vodka. There's nothing particular about vodka, about what's the name of the vodka? Absolute vodka. The bottle is the same, everything is the same, but because it is conceptualized in the environment of Warhol's idea of what vodka is about, it is in therefore enhancing vodka. Warhol's an artist, conceptual artist, whatever, right? So he's an artist. Vodka is liquor, right? Is it hard liquor? What do you call it? Liquor, hard liquor? Yep. So they're unrelated, right? Unrelated products. Okay. Next one. De Beers. Anybody, well, everybody probably know about De Beers diamonds, the best diamonds in the world that money can buy. De Beers had launched a campaign in 1968 using art images, and the idea is to convey, right, the idea that diamonds, like paintings, are unique works of art. Okay, so this particular images are from 1968, De Beers advertising campaign. Can you see, right? So the whole sheet is part of the ad campaign, and the artist is, if I pronounce it right, Herbert Katzman, right? Katzman, finding a world. So it is the art, and what they do is, it's hard to see, but the diamonds are right here. As you can see, diamonds. And the description of the diamond, you can't read, right? The diamonds are here. But yeah, and then they give the description of the diamonds and whatnot, but this is unrelated, right? Unrelated object. So what would it be? Two functions, remember? What would it be? Enhance, correct. Enhance an unrelated product, that is diamond, De Beers diamond. And another one is 1959, De Beers artist Lenore Wood, Time of Love. lifetime of love. Again, De Beers Diamonds Advertising. As we can see, the usage of artwork on the walls for interior design decor. Hotel's lobby, as you can see, copy of the art, right? You see on the walls. Hotel's lobby, as you can see right there on the right side. Fashion, Farfetch, Dolce & Gabbana, Virgin Mary and Baby Jesus, print t-shirt, as you can see. And it's quite. I don't see the price. Somehow the price is not included, but you can Google. It's about $300 per t-shirt. And then we have. I didn't ask you. Yeah. So what would this be? What's the purpose of the art? Is to do what? To enhance the interior design. What about this art? To enhance the hotel's lobby, to enhance the environment of the hotel. What about, again? To enhance the environment, to make it better, right? To make it exclusive, to make it luxurious, right? What about t-shirts? What about t-shirts? Integrated. Iconic status of those both. Correct.
Yes,
and that's what the topic is about. This talk is about. That's exactly what you're saying. Yes, it's called spillover. Hold on, spillover effect. That's what you're saying. Yes, correct. Yes, it makes t-shirt cost $300. And then we have pizza. Right? What do we see? Prayer or a beautiful painting-like image on the image of the cover of a pizza box. Okay. So one of the things that we need to define is how do we define art? In for this particular talk, we are going to base our assumptions on consumer-centric, meaning what consumers think art is. Because in this particular context is what we need to know for this particular context. So a survey has been conducted to define art. And 77 participants took that survey, and they were asked to take survey and distinguish art images from non-art images. And the results were that art images were relevant to high art, or well-established masters of Western visual art, and therefore those images, art images that were associated with masters of the Western visual art, they evoke connotations or the meanings, right? Connotations or the meaning of sophistication, culture, luxury, and prestige. So that's what we're talking about, right? Evoking that iconic images, right? Iconic images, a well-known iconic images of the art represent connotations of sophistication, culture, luxury, and prestige. And that's what we're talking about now. Um, The question is whether the presence of visual arts spills over, right, onto consumer products. The feeling of luxury, exclusiveness, will it or does it, do they spill over onto consumer products? And we're all aware of the effect of music, right? The effect of music on products. It's very interesting, but research shows that listening to music, to liked versus disliked music, while being exposed to a product, directly affect product preferences. Product preferences. Now, what about odor? What about odor and the products? Anybody? Odor, the smell. In the retail? Triggers, yes, memories. And the research actually shows that odor reveal that ambient sense, it influence consumers' perceptions in the retail environment, positive or negative. What about art? What about art and products? Does it affect, is there a spillover effect on art, of art onto consumer products? There are two influences that I would like of the art products, of the art images onto the consumer products. There are two of them, and this is kind of quite heavy, but it's easy. Number one is content-dependent influence of art, meaning if the content actual of art is negative or positive. Mm-hmm. So if it's positive, it will positively influence the perception of that art unto consumer, and vice versa. If the content is negative, it will negatively influence the perception of consumer perception of that product. Okay, that's what content dependent influence of art. Number two, generalized content independent influence of art. And that's what we're talking about, that generally speaking, iconic art, especially of masters of Western civilization, has already connotation of high culture. That is exclusivity, luxury, and sophistication. So by default, when we have association, products or environments with art that is of Western masters, you will have a direct perception. You will create a perception right away of exclusivity, luxury, and sophistication. And no wonder Gucci has Jesus images and Mary's images on their bags, underwears, t-shirts, right, jackets, and so on and so forth. That's part of why. Now I would like to share with you a very interesting, there are two studies actually that has been done to prove it. The effect of art, spillover effect of art onto consumer products. So let's see, study number one. So what they did in study number one, they've conducted a research with a restaurant, and they had 100 patrons in exchange for conducting a customer satisfaction service. So they promised them that they will ask their patrons, their customers, right, restaurant customers, questions. They survey them, and in return they're going to give them customer satisfaction survey anyway. The study has been conducted during the most busiest time for the restaurant, that is weekend. And some of the statistics is that the study participants, they were 53% males and 47 females, average age of 43 years, and average income of 5,600 per month in 2008. The survey was conducted in 2008. The object, the target stimuli, was a typical set of, and you can see that, a typical set of silverware, a set of spoon, fork, knife, teaspoon, and steak knife. Black velvet, that's very important here. Please pay attention. Black velvet boxes, as you can see those boxes, were custom made for the study by a professional designer. The interior of the boxes were lined with white satin on which the silverware was placed. The top, that's very interesting, the top of the box had a print of either Van Gogh, Café Terrace at Night, that is art image, or and photograph of a café at night, that is non-art image. Now, they conducted a pretest to identify which image will be considered art, right? To see what consumers will consider art. So, they pretested these images, the covers, right? What you see, images with 20 participants. They presented the two images to participants side by side. They asked them to look at the images and report. Now, the pretest revealed that the art, that's very interesting, that the art image, that is Van Gogh, Café Terrace at Night, was identified as art to a greater degree than the non-art image. Okay. Now, procedure. It's very interesting. Procedure. What happened? So how did they survey people? What they did is that each time the food was served, they approached customers with those two boxes, and before they opened them, they showed them the cover of the boxes, so they can see them vividly, and then they opened them. Now, the results. The art image led to higher product evaluation than the non-art image, so the study demonstrates the phenomenon of art infusion, which is artifact, in the restaurant, and the result reveals that spillover of luxury perceptions leading to favorable evaluation of the product. So, therefore, the product that had the cover that had art on them versus not art, which is a photo, right? Photograph has higher preference than the non-art image. Next. Study number two. Now, the second study is been done with soap dispensers. And you can see right here, these are the three soap dispensers. An art, three objects, three images on each soap dispensers. An artwork with positive content, an art with negative content, and a photograph with content similar to that of the positive artwork. Now, I'll tell you a little more about, okay, so Claude Monet painting, Palazzo da Mula, the depicting building overlooking at Venetian Canal, henceforth referencing to as Monet. Now, do we see that? Is over here. Okay, Monet painting of the canal. Number two is a photograph, as you can see, of buildings overlooking a Venetian Canal. And number three, item number three, is Turner's painting The Burning of the House of Lords and Commons. It is in 1834, depicting the violent image of burning buildings on the banks of the River Thames. And so three images. Okay. Now, what was the method and procedure for this study? 76 undergraduate students participated in this study, and each was randomly assigned to one of three experimental conditions: the soap dispenser with the Turner painting, the soap dispenser with the Monet painting, and the soap dispenser with the photograph of Venetian canal. Now, the results. The results is that very interesting. The preferences were given to the images where soap dispensers had art images on them versus a photograph. Preferences were given to image number one and three. Now, that's very interesting. Now, do you remember I mentioned when an art, if the art has negative content, then it's, we consumers do not prefer that object. So what about this burning of the negative content of the painting? So that's very interesting. It shows the results revealed no significant differences between the two. So people still, consumers chosen objects with soap dispensers with arts on them, images on them, with them, versus, gave preference, versus the image with the photograph.
Why?
In the content of this research, we give preferences to the product consumer products that have art objects, art images on them, no matter if the content is negative. Now, I would like to now share very interesting, I think, information, kind of the result of this presentation, of this content that I shared with you, some practical implementation and what needs to be done further. Now, we can use art as a tool in our marketing campaigns. Now, the question is, how will marketers know what kind of art to use? And then what their demographics or what their target market think of what art is? So these are the questions. How would you know as a marketer, as someone who is building the brand content, brand campaign strategy for your company, for your brand, how would you know what kind of art to use? So you would probably need to do some kind of pre-test to know what your consumers, your target market consider art. That's a question. That's a struggle, right? So that's something that we as we need to work on. Number two, in this particular content context that I just shared, as I said, the limitation is that I've been referring to the classic exemplars of Western visual art. So that's the limitation for this particular talk. Number three is that we visual art works harder for functional products. So not always you can use art images in your in building your campaign, advertising campaign, not always. For example, products like hedonic products. That's an interesting word. Hedonic is products that we buy for enjoyment, fun. So like De Beers diamonds, right? Or China, or right? So something that we don't have to have or we'll buy it. So art presence, right? When we use art in those advertising those products, it works best. Versus if we want to use art in products like rugged outdoors products, such as survival gear, or powerful trucks, that might be not a good idea to use art images, okay? And as I said before, there's a huge gap in the knowledge of what I'm talking about. There's still a huge gap of understanding the influence and effect of art images in conjunction with advertising and what that impact does to the consumers and how consumers form their perceptions of that product that is being advertised with art images. Okay, so it's just as I said, it's just the beginning, but at least it gives you an idea of what Gucci's and Swarovski's and Cartier's and Tiffany's of the world are doing when they use art in their ad campaigns. As you could see, De Beers, the diamonds, using art, right, in their ad campaigns. Do you have any questions or and then the results, do we get in? So maybe we'll give who did not take a survey. I would like, so we have how many we have how many participants we have,
so complete.
Eight. Okay, so do we have, so we had a couple of questions, right? The survey, there were three questions, and you were to choose your favorite artwork. So you were supposed to review the artwork work in the gallery, and then answer the question. Review the and then choose one of your favorite pieces, and then ask yourself, would you turn this piece into a consumer product? And which is, you know, a dress, a scarf, right? So yes or no first, right? And then we ask you, if yes, what kind of consumer product would it be? Okay, so you're gonna give us an example of a consumer product that you would like to create with your chosen favorite artwork, and then what attracted you in this artwork? Do we have? No. We've already chosen. Yeah. So what do we have?
So for question number one, there was 100% yes. Everybody said that they would turn their favorite piece of art into some type of garment. For the second one, we had a few different responses as to what kind of product it would be, but we got things like dresses, blankets, clothing. One person said, I could see a beautiful printed silk made into a flowing gown, and one other person said, clothing, jackets, gowns, or leggings, or even a throw pillow. So, I mean, tons of different ideas going there. And then for the last one, what attracted you to this artwork? A lot of them was vibrant, delightful, bright colors, unique patterns, color range, level of overall symmetry and visual length, and rhythm, color, and the emotion. So these were the things that really attracted you guys to these pieces and made you want to make them into a product.
Perfect, thank you. Yeah. Thank you so much. So the result, as I said at the beginning of my talk, the result justifies what I've just been talking to you for the last 45 minutes or so. What it means is that when we see an art, there is a want to, there's a want to be associated with that art, and we want to wear it in the form of a scarf or a dress, or have it in our wallpaper or a pillow, mm-hmm. or leggings, mm-hmm. or hats, accessories, bags, and so on and so forth. So you've just justified my my curiosity, and well, not only my curiosity, but the actual point of this conversation is that we do have feelings and emotions connected to a piece of art. So we do have, we do communicate, and we do develop emotional connections and feelings with objects, such as art objects. So this gives you just a little window to the knowledge, to the amount of knowledge that Chanel, Cartier, Ferrari of the world collecting throughout all those years and using to attract you, your attention, to retain your attention, to make you a loyal follower, and to spend money.
Yep.
Yep.
Lots of
money. Lots of money.
Yes. Let's make our choice.
Ferrari people won't buy whatever. What's another car? Okay. Ferrari.
Petro.
Thank you for coming. Can you make images? Can you work with Petro and take pictures?
Petro.